In this morning, as we prepare to get underway very shortly and give these last few seconds to people to launch themselves into the webinar with a warm coffee or tea mug in hand. So welcome and let's begin, folks. Tēnā koutou katoa, no mai haere mai. Well, welcome everyone to this Auckland Community Funding Fair webinar, version 2. Ko Simon Ritchie, toko ingoa from the team here at ANCAD, Auckland North Community and Development. I'm involved in the training and capability space with ANCAD. We're a community development organisation established in 1974. I wasn't around at that time, but focused on developing the capability and capacity of community organisations. So thank you for joining this webinar. It's great to have you all with us to hear from our speakers today who come from some wonderful funding organisations. We really appreciate them giving of their time to us today, and we thank and appreciate all funders who may be in attendance today as well. I'm filling in this morning on behalf of our ANCAD General Manager, Fiona Brennan, in giving this welcome, who has emailed me to say that she is currently without voice, but joins us today, nevertheless, watching on. I can say that we are closing in on nearly 300 registrations for this webinar today, which is now the second funding fair, as I mentioned, we've organised this year. So it's a clear indication of the strong interest from community groups such as yourselves right across Tamaki Makaurau in hearing from this up-to-date information to come from our speakers today. So it's my privilege to now hand over to your host today and organiser of this event, Stephanie Maitland from Maitland & Associates, who herself has expertise in funding and strategy and with whom ANCAD has had the pleasure to work with over a number of years. Stephanie will speak to this morning's program and will introduce our speakers. So kia ora, Stephanie.
Thanks, Simon. Kia ora. Hello. Good morning, everyone. As Simon said, my name is Stephanie Maitland, and it's certainly my pleasure to be your host this morning. Having completed hundreds of funding applications and worked with many schools, sports organisations and charities across New Zealand, I appreciate how important this funding source is for everyone. So some housekeeping things. A copy of the slides will be emailed to all registered attendees, and the webinar is also being recorded. So a link to and information on how to watch that will also be sent. At the end of each presentation, the speaker will answer your questions. So please put your questions in the Q&A box as you think of them. That is the box we will be monitoring. In case you might not be aware, ANCAD offers a range of educational opportunities through its LIFT program. Upcoming workshops include, sorry, I know that my screen's working. Upcoming workshops include funding options for your organisation. That's a Zoom one on the 18th of August. And strategic grant seeking and writing, which might be a benefit to you all given to, your interest in today's topic. And that's a half day session in person on the 25th of August. Other upcoming ones is some other funding options by some person by the name of Stephanie Maitland. Hopefully it'll be worthwhile for you. We're gonna cover donations, bequests, business support and events. Come along, it'll be fun. It's on Zoom, so you can register. Through the LIFT website, the information is there. They have a wide range of upcoming seminars that's supported by the Tyndall Foundation. Another great resource is the funding directory that ANCAD produces. There are a few copies of the printed version left, and you can also access, download a PDF version. Please go to the ANCAD website on the publications tab on orders on how to get a copy. It's packed full of information about funders that you'll be able to apply to. Our program for today, our first speakers are from the SkyCity Auckland Community Trust. Then we have Stewart from the Public Trust. They administer a number of private family trusts. There's the ANZ Staff Foundation. And then we have a gaming machine trust, the Lion Foundation. And then we'll do our thank yous and our close. But before we welcome our first speaker, Simon, back to you. You have our first poll for today.
All right, here we go, folks. So our first poll is about to launch. Are you responsible for preparing the funding applications for your organisation? Please answer yes or no. Okay, just finishing the poll result there. Thank you for participating, and here are the results.
So 85% of you are responsible for your funding application. So great, you're in the right place for today. There will be lots of information to assist you with that over the course of the next hour and a half or so. So remember to put your questions in for each speaker in the Q&A box. Now, first speaker for today, it's my pleasure to welcome Raewynne Jacobs, Community Trust Manager, and Waione Te Pā, the Community Trust Administrator from SkyCity Auckland Community Trust. Delighted that you're able to join us today, ladies. Over to you.
Thanks, Simon and Stephanie, for inviting us to participate today. And just if you can just give me a thumbs up if you can hear me clearly. Awesome. Okay, I'm just going to share my screen. But I think, first off, I just want to acknowledge actually that it's the 25th birthday of the Sky Tower today. And so we kind of tried to position our screen so you can actually see the tower in the back of our meeting room. So happy 25th birthday to the tower. And yeah, like, I wish I was that young. But let's start our presentation. Just finding it. There we go. Share. Okay, and I'm hoping everybody can see my screen. Thumbs up, please. Okay. So as Stephanie said, my name's Raewynne Jacobs, and I've got Waione Te Pā with me. We are the two staff members of the SkyCity Auckland Community Trust, and thanks for this opportunity to present to, I think, a significant audience in terms of organisations that are applying to funders such as ourselves for funding. So if you have any questions as I'm talking, please pop them in the chat, and hopefully we'll be able to deal with the questions once we've finished this presentation. Is it moving through? No. Obviously not moving. I'm just going to go like that. So the trust, we operate three trusts in New Zealand. We are part of SkyCity in Auckland, Hamilton and Queenstown. And so it's quite exciting to be able to work with those communities in those locations. So we're not just specific to Auckland. The funding from the trust here in Auckland comes from the casino. And we operate with a specific license from the Gambling Commission, which is a little bit different from your Class 4 gaming machine trust license. The trust started in 1996, and we've distributed just under $54 million over that time to about 2,500 organisations. And we distribute to Auckland and Northland, so we're kind of Tāmaki and Taitokoro are the areas that we cover. As we said, myself and Waione are the two staff members that look after the SkyCity Trust. So that is Auckland, Hamilton and Queenstown. And just on the right there, we've popped on a photo of our trustees. So our trust is chaired by Marama Royal and Sue Suckling. And our trustees are Don Mann, Te Arapa Morihu, Rosie Nathan, Vicinia Marka, Prue Etchbury, and Wee Petty Amita. So those are our trustees that will help us look after the trust. And actually there's one person that I have forgotten in that list, and it's probably the most important person, and it's Julie Amy. And Julie is actually the Chief Financial Officer of SkyCity. So one, she just makes sure that actually the trust receives the right return from the casino so that we can contribute back to community.
Raewynne, just before you go to the next slide, do you want to just press that from the beginning at the top of your...
From the beginning, that might help me actually, Stephanie.
It should, and then just move across to the next slide that you were on to.
Okay, so where I'm up to now, so that was our trustees. I've just gone blank. Okay, so during 2019, the SkyCity Trust actually undertook quite a significant review of actually how it operated. Our trustees, we've got a trustees that had been appointed through connections with SkyCity or with friends or family who have a connection with us. We went through a process for all three trusts where we actually advertised in the community for trustees, and that's how we came about to receive the group of trustees that we have. And so now when we have a vacancy, we go through that same process. So we haven't had a vacancy in Auckland since 2019, but we have in Hamilton and Queenstown. So we advertise in the community to actually see who in the community is interested in coming on board as a trustee. We interview, we look for community experience, and then our trust deed says that the settlor of the trust actually has the final say in how we appoint our trustees. And so the settlor is Michael Ahern, who is the CEO of SkyCity. So that's how we appoint our trustees now. Each of the three trusts actually reviewed its funding and focus in the way that funds were distributed. So what we've seen across all trusts is kind of a reduction in the number of organisations that we fund, but probably more substantial grants for those organisations that are really clearly aligned with the focus of what each of the trusts is about. So we were quite a traditional kind of transactional scattergun funder. We've kind of moved away from it to be a much more strategic and impactful funder. And so if you wanted to have a look at our website, you'll see actually how, you know, the types of groups that we're funding and the dollar value that we're funding, which is quite a difference from how we used to operate. So our vision for Auckland is engaged and connected equals thriving communities. We have a whakatauki, te piko o te mahuri, te tuku o te rākau. The way in which the young sapling is nurtured or bent determines how the tree will grow. So that whakatauki is very much around supporting our rangatahi and our young people. So our rangatahi is what we consider our sapling. And so we want to nurture our sapling or our rangatahi to ensure that we are supporting our rangatahi with our development. So that's why our vision and values now really focus on projects that demonstrate the development and well-being of rangatahi and solutions and decisions to support the well-being and development of rangatahi. So it's quite a specific focus area that we're looking to fund now. So we, as I said, we used to be a very traditional grant maker. We've really moved away from that and now really funding the development of rangatahi within what I consider the context of supporting them from their whānau or from their community. So that's very much what we're looking at the moment. Who can apply? Charitable organisations. So we have charitable purposes. Organisations that operate from the far north to the Bombay Hills. Projects or programs that support our vision and focus that are supporting rangatahi development. Trustees define those rangatahi as those that are leaving school. So we're not funding children at school. So we're not funding any school-based programs, but we're supporting children or rangatahi actually out of school environments. Really important actually with any funder, and I think Stewart would probably agree with me here, you know, always check our exclusions list. Unfortunately, we do have an exclusions list. So there are some types of groups or services that we're not able to fund. But once again, it's actually going to our website and having a look at what we don't fund. We have three funding streams, and our harakeke there is how we also consider our rangatahi. And at the centre of the harakeke is our rangatahi, and the leaves are on the fronds on the outside are our community and our whānau. So once again, using that same analogy, he kākano is what we consider our seed grants, which are for new initiatives or projects, startup funding, generally small grants. So that's right at the kind of what we call our seed grants or he kākano. The tupu are projects which will be focused on the outcomes and the priorities of the trust. So once again, but probably we have two funding rounds. I'm going to come into that in a little minute. And then hupuawai, we're looking to bring about extensive change resulting in intergenerational impact. And once again, that's kind of the outer leads where we're going to be trying to test a few ideas with a couple of groups to look at bringing about kind of more systemic change. So he kākano. So as I said, new initiatives or projects, small grants, the grant range under he kākano have ranged from about 2,500 this year up to 10,000. It's kind of the range that we will look at under he kākano. Decisions are made by delegated authority by myself and the co-chairs. There's actually no closing dates for requests under he kākano. So basically, we're dealing with them as they come in. There's no application form. It's basically a letter from you, from your organisation, a budget in terms of how you want to use the funding, how your project will align with your kākano in terms of being a new initiative or project, And as you can see there, we've funded 5 grants this year, and quite low, only because this is actually a really new strategy for us. Hopefully in this next financial year, we'll be able to look at investing more into those kind of small grants under Hei Kākano. E Tipu, which is the our main grant stream. So this is once again focusing on rangatahi development. It's where the bulk of our funding sits. It is by application, which we've got funding rounds open twice a year. I'm just going to pop through here actually. So our Hei Tipu funding round is actually open now. So if any organisations are interested in Hei Tipu, please have a look at our website, and I'm going to give you the link later on, and also that will be available in the presentation that will come out. So we use Smarty grants to receive applications under Hei Tipu. Last year we funded 49 organisations and spent just over $2.6 million under Hei Tipu, which is kind of a far cry from the days when we'd spend, you know, we'd have like 150 or 200 groups actually receiving funding. So it's much more kind of intentional, funding a smaller number of organisations, very focused on rangatahi. And once again, you can see the range of grants from 6,300 up to 200,000. And we also will look at multi-year grants in there as well. As you can see, the budget, 2.6 million, generally the trust gives away about just over 3 million. So that's kind of where the bulk of this funding sits. So Hei Tipu is open at the moment and it will close next Friday the 12th. Hei Pūāwai is where we want to look at kind of more significant investments and look at how we can bring about kind of extensive change resulting in intergenerational impact for rangatahi. We're looking at how we co-invest with other funders. We want to look at actually how we can collaborate. We will look at multi-year grants under Hei Pūāwai. And I've got an example up on there just around how we've funded the Kindness Institute in partnership with the Ministry for Youth Development for a rangatahi program. And that grant is actually for 2 years. So we're in the second year of funding for the Kindness Institute with Ministry for Youth Development right now. So under Hei Pūāwai, we only funded 3 organisations, which is probably about right because the grants that we would tend to fund under Hei Pūāwai are more significant grants. And are often multi-year grants as well. With Hei Pūāwai, so as I said, Hei Kākano is a letter. Hei Tipu is where you put an application in through Smarty grants. Hei Pūāwai is a two-stage process where you look to originally the first offer from you is where you'll actually just send us an email and say, "Hey, Raewynne and Waione, I've got an idea for a Hei Pūāwai project. This is my idea. What do you think?" And then we will actually have a discussion with you. If we think it fits well with Hei Pūāwai and what our trustees' intent is, we will let you know, and then we will report back to our trustees, and then they will let us know if they want us to continue to have a conversation with you around funding under Hei Pūāwai, or they might say, "Actually, I think that fits better under Hei Tipu." So Hei Pūāwai is very much that two-stage process. Have a conversation with us and we will be able to guide you from there. Just in terms of how to find us and find out more information about the trust, SkyCity Auckland Community Trust, this is a link. So it's actually under our local SkyCity Auckland website. So www.skycityauckland.co.nz. You'll find information about the trust, the trustees, what we fund, what we don't fund, what's new. And then if you want to talk to us about anything in particular, we've got our email address up there as well, inquiries@skycitycommunitytrust.org.nz. And then Waione and I receive those emails, and then we will respond to you from there. And I'm going to stop sharing now. My last slide is any questions. So actually, Stephanie, I think I'll let you, I'll stop sharing. I'll let you manage that if that's okay.
Yes, that's great. That's great. Thank you.
Thank you.
questions. So one that's come through, can a faith-based community organisation apply for this funding with you?
Yes, totally. If a faith-based organisation is happy to apply to a casino trust for funding, they're most welcome to apply. And that's often a question that organisations need to decide if they're happy to apply to the casino for funding. What we will look at is, like our kaupapa is about supporting rangatahi. So we want to be able to support rangatahi in whatever way that is actually safe for the young person. But definitely we do see faith-based organisations apply all the time. You know, we're a great supporter of the Auckland City Mission, which is a faith-based organisation. They're just down the road from us. We support the mission. We supported them with actually the construction of their facility there. We're trying to work with some of the residents there around in social housing. I'm currently in a discussion with the City Mission around actually what they, you know, if they want to apply to us for funding again now. So yeah, most definitely. Yeah, as long as it's focused on rangatahi and the outcomes that the trustees want to achieve.
Great, thank you. Diane says, thank you very much for your presentation. When you say there are no closing dates, approximately how in advance of the project date would you like to see the application?
I'm assuming that is for He Kākano.
Yes, sorry, it is.
And it's really, yeah, like I think about for an organisation around their own planning, I think it's for the administration in here, I think it'd be unrealistic for us to turn a request around and pay out a grant within a month. But it does, yeah, like if there's an event that's coming up, we would look at, you know, what is the timing for the event, who else is funding it, and all that. So we would have a discussion with the group anyway to just work out what is the timing. But I think realistically, a month would be probably the shortest period of time we could turn a grant around. I have turned them around quicker, but it is just Waione and I, so we're not a big team. The team of two, yeah.
Very important, team number two. Thank you. Further question. So if you don't have any legal entity, so the question is, can an unincorporated society apply? So by that, I mean, I assuming they mean that they don't have any legal entity, so not an incorporated society or maybe not a charitable trust. Can they apply?
Yeah, most definitely. So we'll look at groups from, I suppose, the big thing that I'm trying to steer away from is actually not supporting individuals or companies. So they're kind of an exclusion. If there's a group that's actually, and we've done quite a few actually, in He Kākano and Underseed with in Hamilton, we'll look to say, actually, have you got a charity to act as your umbrella group to receive this funding? And so what we would just ask from their umbrella group is just an email or a letter and their bank deposits information so we can deposit the money into the charity's bank account, the legal entity. But yeah, we would definitely look at a request from a non-incorporated group.
So just carrying on from there, so you say an umbrella organisation is great. So if the umbrella organisation, can they still apply to you in their own right if they're umbrellaing another organisation, or would you see their umbrella organisation, their application being their one for the year?
No, we'd see it as quite separate, actually.
Okay, yeah. Great. Do you focus particularly on Māori and Pacifica, or are ethnic and migrant rangatahi also a priority?
Most definitely. So I suppose rangatahi is the term that our trustees has used to define young people. And in terms of the discussion with them, in terms of, well, what do you mean by rangatahi? And so particularly with a te ao Māori context, I think we say kind of 16, 17, up to their 40s. So in a Māori worldview, actually, rangatahi is not just, you know, like it includes up to the age of 40, but we will also look at, yeah, refugee and migrant groups, rangatahi in that space. So it's not just Māori and Pacific.
Okay. Are you more likely to fund standalone projects, so you fund the full projects, or projects that have already had confirmed funding from other sources?
Don't really have any feelings on that one. It's either or. So we look at a project in its entirety. So we do have some groups that we will just fund the project. It just depends on the group and the project. we really do try and steer away from just funding annual operating costs. So it's not, we don't want to be seen to be just providing funding into a pot which has no limit. So we're quite interested in funding projects and programs as opposed to just here's $50,000 just to deliver your service. But yeah, and as I said, like the trustees will often look at a project and actually say, we're going to fund this, and they will fund it in its entirety.
Great, thank you. Next question is asking if you could clarify how often your funding rounds are.
So he tupu is twice a year. So we've got one round open now. And so the next round will be on the other side of next year. So our financial year is 1 July to 30 June. So we will have a second round in that kind of second 6 months of our financial year. I don't have a closing date for that at the moment. And so hikakano is just any, they can just come in whenever. I think one of the things actually in hikakano, and I'm just thinking of the policy, I think we will only do one grant per year. So if a group, we wouldn't expect to fund the same group 5 times under hikakano. And with hepuawai, as I said, we funded 3 groups. So you can come in any time with a hepuawai request, and then if we want to put it to trustees, we will line it up with the next trustee meeting. So quite fluid.
Thank you. Next question. We are a social enterprise currently registered as a business, but we don't make any money. We are planning to change and become a trust to apply for and we'll apply for charitable status next month. Is that a barrier to application?
I did one similar to that actually under hikakano in this past financial year. So it was a business that we were a social enterprise, didn't make any money. So we just, the kaupapa of what the group we're wanting to achieve was actually bang on in terms of our strategy. So we funded them, but because they didn't have charitable status, we just paid the grant out to a registered charity. So no, so as long as the kaupapa of the project aligns with our funding focus, it's not a barrier at all.
Great, thank you. Just clarification regarding the regions in Auckland who can apply. So you fund from basically Bombay Hills North. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct.
Okay, working my way down here. Kelly, Raewynne's from the SkyCity Auckland Community Trust. Thank you. Came in late. So we are a startup charity. Some funders require 2 years registration. So does this apply to you?
No, that doesn't apply. But just send us a little bit. I'd say just let us know who you are and what you're wanting to do. Just send us an email and then we can probably advise from there. But we don't require 2 years registration to apply.
Great. Thank you. Sincerely appreciate all the questions and also sincerely appreciate Raewynne and Waione sending your time with us this morning. A copy of your PowerPoint will come through, so I'm sure there'll be some, any additional questions will go via your email address. So thank you. By all means, ladies, you're welcome to stay for the rest of the funding fair. And happy birthday to the Sky Tower. Doesn't seem 25 years ago that it was built, but I was very young then, so I might have forgotten. Our next speaker is Stewart Vartan, the Senior Client Advisor Charities from the Public Trust. Welcome, Stewart. We certainly look forward to hearing from you.
Thank you very much. And a bit afraid following that performance. Let me try and do this.
You'll be fabulous. I have complete faith.
Can everyone see that?
Yes, all good.
Awesome. Okay.
You might just do the, from the
beginning. Yeah, do the... Right.
See them down the sides. Maybe you want to just from the first one up to you, but no, we can see that.
Yeah. Okay. I'm sorry. I didn't know how to set up that one you got set up. Okay. So Public Trust is in a quite a different situation. But just as a bit of a background, Public Trust was established by the government in 1st of January 1873 as the Public Trust Office, and Jonas Woodward was the first public trustee, and its original purpose was to provide trustee services to families particularly widows and orphans who are at risk of being taken advantage of by those they are trusted to manage their funds. In later years, we expanded the trustee services provided to New Zealanders, and we remained a government department until 2001, when we adopted a structure similar to a company as a Crown entity. We work with people on their estate planning, predominantly writing wills, enduring powers of attorney, and trusts, although trusts are not quite so popular nowadays. We also manage or administer estates, carrying out the wishes laid out in our customers' wills. We are one of the country's largest charitable trust administrators and advisors. We administer more than 420 charitable trusts, all with not quite conflicting, but sometimes competing purposes. These are established through wills and trust deeds. The bulk of our trusts have named beneficiaries who receive distributions annually, but we also administer trusts that offer grants towards various charitable purposes within the community. Some trusts have specific purposes, such as providing scholarships or aid and relief to the elderly. Some have very wide purposes, but the scope of the works is limited to a geographic region. And we also have a mixture. We also have those with specific purposes within a set geographic region. We have trusts where the granting is decided by boards or committees established within the government documents, and in other situations, public trust as trustee is to make those decisions on our own. Some of the examples of our trusts, you may have heard of the Thomas George McCarthy Trust. This is our largest trust in terms of value and monetary output. It grants up to 200 grants a year. This is established through the will of Thomas George McCarthy, and it grants to charitable and educational organisations within the Wellington region, and this includes Whanganui, south of Turangi, Manawatu, Horowhenua, and the Wairarapa. And this granting is decided by the Trust Board. The Frozen Funds Charitable Trust was established through a trustee by the Crown Health Financing Agency and the Acting Minister of Health at the time. This fund was established through a fund that hospitals in New Zealand held for the benefits of its patients. The original fund came from a variety of sources, and including accumulated payments, bequests, money held by patients at the time of admission, and comforts money. And the purpose of that trust is to provide assistance to people in New Zealand who have been or are users of mental health and or intellectual disability services. In particular, to provide assistance of people who are current or former patients of mental institutions and inpatient facilities. We've got a brand new trust that we've just taken on, the Infrastructure Education and Training Charitable Trust. And this was established by a deed dated last year, 26th of November, 2021, by the Infrastructure Industry Training Organisation Incorporated, who aka Connexus. And the purpose of that trust is to distribute income and capital to develop, promote, and facilitate education and training within the infrastructure industry so as to increase the general and specific competencies which contribute to the effectiveness of employees within that industry. This trust is slightly different to most. Most of our trusts are perpetual. This one, while it doesn't have a distribution date, the expectation is that it will eventually be fully distributed and wound up. How to find our trusts? So if you're looking for opportunities to apply for granting, you can find them on our public trust website. And if you when I share this, publication with you, if you just hit control and click on it, it'll take you right to that website. And the search engine is separated into sections as shown below. Trusts that provide for individuals and organizations or other trusts. And there's an image of what it looks like. The keywords, if you go back up, we've got keywords, region, and sector. The keywords are the name of the trust, if you know it, You can also search by geographic region and sector. Excuse me. The sectors are the areas of charitable activity. As below, as you got all, obviously, arts and culture, education, general charitable purposes, postgraduate educational research, social and community. How to apply. Most of our grant rounds are administered through the Smarty Grants Administration tool. This is actually an Australia-based company, but you can find them information on them on a New Zealand website shown there. Very few of our grant rounds have application forms linked directly to the Public Trust webpage. When you have found a trust that may cater to the purposes of your organisation or your project, you need to ensure a current grant round is open, and that is information is shown on the Public Trust website. And also, that trust will have an Apply Now button on its page if it is open, as shown here. See two Apply Now buttons there. And when you click on the Apply Now button, it will take you to the Smarty Grants Grant Round Information Sheet, which will repeat the information from the PT website and go into more detail about the public application process. And we'll just go through an example of that. Excuse me. This is for a scholarship round, and this is for individuals, students of the Oriwa College, very specific purpose. Yeah, as you can see, it's got who is eligible, how much is available, what it can be used for, and how to apply. Terms and conditions, just a couple of warning notes. Trustee's decision is final. Late applications will not be accepted, and important dates. And we do offer multi-year granting for this trust, just as an example. Talking about what the committee reserves the right to. And the rest of this information is actually information from Smarty Grants on how to use the Smarty Grants webpage. So from here, if we go back, I'll just go back a couple of pages. You'll see there's a start a submission there. And so from there, you'd click that start a submission button, which will take you to the online application form. And at this stage, you'll be asked to log in to Smarty Grants or register to, into Smarty Grants if you've not already got a registration. And when you log in, Smarty Grants will take you directly to the correct application form for the trust that you're wanting to apply to. And that's the login or register page. So just a few things to note. Once you've registered, you'll be able to use your login for future applications with various trusts. Each application form is drafted to suit the nature of each trust that we administer. Things to note, and this is mentioned on the Smarty Grants on the information page, please read the instructions carefully. Make sure you are eligible to apply. Once you start, an application number will be assigned to you. Please complete the application as accurately and succinctly as possible and use your common sense. Please provide supporting documentation as requested. It's a warning, please save regularly so you do not lose any of the information you have input. And you will need to complete all required fields before you submit. It will not allow you to submit unless you have. If you have any questions while you're applying, you can email us via funding at publictrust.co.nz, or you can call us on 0800 371 471. Late applications will only be accepted in certain circumstances that are beyond your control. For example, if Smarty Grants crashes while you are trying to submit, then yes, we will allow an extension. When you have successfully submitted an application, you will receive an email confirming the submission. If you have not received that email, your application was not successfully submitted. And then just before you make call us, please check your junk box or spam email as well, just to make sure it's not in there. After you've applied, Public Trust will review the applications and either decide on the outcomes or refer them to the board committee panel for their decisions. And then we'll email all applicants with the outcomes. And due to the number of applications we normally get, we're not able to give explanations to all unsuccessful applicants. But just note, we do receive many applications and our trusts have limited funds to grant. Okay, any questions? Let me stop sharing my screen. How do I do that? There we go.
You should have a stop share button.
Yes, yes, sorry. It's very new to me.
All good. Loving the picture in your background.
Thank you.
thanks, Stuart. That was great. So, questions. I have one. How open is the public trust or the trustees of each trust to meeting with or hearing from people before they apply around, is this an application or a project you're interested in? Would you like to come and see what we're doing? Is that possible?
It is possible. It's quite difficult, I think, for us because we do have competing timeframes within our trusts. I myself administer just under 200 trusts on my own, and we do get a lot of inquiries as to, do you have any trusts that will support this purpose? So and we do respond as quickly as possible. As far as visiting, that might be difficult. For example, I live in Wellington. Some of my team lives in Timaru. One's in Christchurch. So geographically, we are limited in where we can go. But we're always open to meeting people out in the community, obviously.
Great. Thank you. Questions, so just a reminder, put your questions in for Stewart in the Q&A box. Question, does the public trust have any influence on which charities are included in a will?
No. No, we are not allowed to influence that sort of decision. That is up to the person writing the will. We would guide them in what is viable. And it does depend on what that person wants to support. For example, back in the day, we've got a lot of trusts that we're granting towards orphanages. Now, orphanages in this country no longer exist. So we have to go through and change and somehow work out how we're going to use those funds, but keeping them in line with the original purpose, as closely to the original purposes of the trust we are able to. But when writing a will, we can guide and say, well, that's not a valid option or something like that. But we do need to cater the purposes to the wishes of the will maker and for the set laws of the trust in that case.
Thank you. Are there any grants specifically for environmental outcomes within the trust that you administer?
Not mine, not the ones that I administer. I think that's quite, I do have one, my apologies. I know of one, and it's a very specific area down in the Mount Cook region that we administer that trust. It was established to care for that particular station. But I think that's the only one that I know of. Within public trust.
Thank you. Another question, what is the source of money for your trust? Is gambling activities money included in your money?
No, we receive funds from settlors or estates of people who have passed away, and we invest that money, and the income or the capital are then paid out as per their wishes.
Would it be possible to have a Zoom or phone call with someone prior to filling out the application form, just to put forward information about the organisation and project that may not be contained in the application, to check we definitely fit the criteria?
Yes, very possible. Just call the 0800 number or email the funding inbox. We get a lot of those queries.
Great. Thank you. Do you know of any trusts who support lower decile Auckland schools?
Funnily enough, I do. I administer one called the Nolan Charitable Trust. I think it's a 3-year cycle. Every third year, we grant funds to lower decile schools in Auckland to help with their library and I think activities for the students, camps and things like that. We don't ask for applications. We just get a list of the lower decile schools and find out how much money we've got available and then grant equally to each.
So that person who asked that question needs to email you to make sure they're on the list.
Yes, yeah.
Personally, I find the public trust website easy to go, whether I'm applying for an organisation or an individual, all the information is there, easy to click through, tells me what you fund, when the closing dates are, how much to apply for, all of that. It's great. So a tip for others, I have a reminder in my Outlook that pops up on the first of every month, just to remind me to check the public trust website to see what's open, whether there's any new trusts that have come on board. And it might be something similar that you might like to do because, time whizzes on by and it's time, and so having that reminder is very useful for me.
I also think a few of our trusts are mentioned on Generosity New Zealand. If you're ever in there, have a look. You might get pointed towards us.
Yes. Sorry, one last question for you. Are there any trusts that focus on migrant and ethnic communities? Putting you on the spot there, Stewart.
Yes, I know.
And while you're thinking, I know you've got a number of trusts who support families and youth, and so potentially some of the projects that people might have in mind might fit under those options. It's certainly worth having a look on the website and taking some time to read through. They're all listed there, whether they're open or not, so you are able to do some homework prior.
Yeah, but I don't think we have any trust that are specifically set up towards that area. But as you say, there are general charitable purposes that will fit into. But again, as I say, we've got over 400 and I don't know every one of them. Sorry.
That's okay. You're allowed. Stewart, thank you. I appreciate you joining us today. Certainly the public trust have, as you say, a large number of trusts, and it's well worth taking some time to read through them and making a list of ones that you could apply to, and then keeping an eye on those as to closing dates, etc. So thank you. It's brilliant that you're able to join us today.
Oh, you're very welcome, and it's been a pleasure.
Thank you.
I also will leave. I do have to get back to work. I'm sorry.
That's just fine. Thank you.
Take care, everyone. Thanks very much.
Thanks, Stewart. Time for another poll. Simon, you have another question for all the attendees.
Okay, here we go, folks. So we'll just see if we can find our next question. Poll 2, how long have you been completing funding applications? And here's a selection to choose from. We're getting near 100%, so thank you so much, everyone. We'll close this poll in a few seconds. 80%, leaving room for any more that wish to participate. And we'll close it off now.
Okay, so the majority of you have been doing applications for less than a year. It's a lot of funding out there. There are a lot of options available to secure funding. So hopefully what we have covered today will be of use, and what we continue to cover will also be of use, which brings us to our next speaker. Simon, it's good to see you. Our next speaker is Simon Howard. He's the Government Relations and Corporate Responsibility Advisor for ANZ Bank and is here to talk to us today regarding the ANZ Staff Foundation. I appreciate you joining us today, Simon. I know it wasn't as straightforward for you as it was for others, so I appreciate that you're here. So over to you.
No worries at all. And you can hear me fine? Just double checking before I start?
All good.
Awesome. And kia ora koutou, everyone. And thank you so much to ANCAD and Stephanie for inviting us to speak with you today. First of all, I hope I can give you all a good overview of what our ANZ New Zealand Staff Foundation is about and how your worthy causes can apply for funding from us, whether that's in the very short or medium term future. Apologies, I haven't got slides for you today, and I am very new to this role myself, so I might not be the greatest with the Q&A at the end, but I promise I'll write anything down and get back to you. So first of all, what is the ANZ New Zealand Staff Foundation? Well, we're one of New Zealand's leaders in payroll giving. We have almost 2,000 staff at the bank contributing regular amounts from their salaries and wages. And the bank matches these contributions at a rate of $2 for every dollar donated by staff, with all of the funds going to the New Zealand Staff Foundation. ANZ covers all of the administrative costs of running the foundation, so 100% of the staff donations go to you, the charities. Almost one in four of our staff contribute across the country, which makes us, as I said, one of the largest payroll giving programs in New Zealand. And this sort of ties nicely into ANZ's wider purpose, really, which is shaping a world where people and communities thrive. So the Staff Foundation is an integral part of that. The foundation's existed since 2000. And in that time, it's distributed close to $9 million in community grants to more than 960 charities and community projects nationwide. So we're closing in on 1,000 charities, which will hit either in this current funding round or early next year, and hopefully the $10 million mark not long after that. In the last two funding rounds since last August, we've distributed over $1.1 million to just over 90 charities. But in that same time, we've had requests from more than 250 charities, totaling more than 3.5 million. So as I'm sure you know, the need is always greater, right? And so we're actively encouraging our staff as much as possible to join so that we can do more to help you guys. So we've got a real emphasis within the Staff Foundation on supporting local community groups. Given the large number and the geographic spread of our foundation members, we consider that sort of the most appropriate way of ensuring the grants that we make are spread to the widest possible number of regions. So we don't just focus on four or five larger charities, say, we spread it across. So I mentioned our funding rounds. Well, we've got two funding rounds every year, and there is one currently open now as we speak, which closes in less than a fortnight on Monday the 15th of August at 5 p.m. So what's that? 12 days. Each round we have open for about a month and a half. So if that's too short a timetable for you, if you're just hearing about us now, we have got another one coming up in January, which closes mid-February. It does take us time to go through all the steps that we need to go through when our funding rounds close. So for the one that's about to close on the 15th of August, the charities likely won't hear the outcome for about 10 weeks. So we aim to distribute the funds around the end of October, possibly into early November. And you're probably thinking, why does it take so long to make that decision? Well, we've got a Staff Foundation Advisory Board here at ANZ that's made up of 12 staff who are really passionate about the work that the foundation does in the community, who've very often been with the bank for a long, long time. They're often involved in community projects themselves, and together they review, and then we have a big board meeting where they'll decide which charities we will be able to support in any given funding round. And it's never an easy discussion, but we do look to support as many charities across as many sectors and across the country. So once our advisory board give their recommendations, that goes up to our staff foundation trustee, and they give the final stamp of approval on who gets funding. So charities can apply in each funding round, but you can only receive funding once per year. So if you were successful in, say, this August round, you wouldn't be able to receive funding in the January-February round. You need to wait until next August. And if you're one of the lucky charities that got funded in February earlier this year, you can't apply in this one now, but next February's will be fine. So what are the criteria that we look for to support with our grants? Well, you have to be a registered New Zealand charity on the charities register, whose work fulfills one or more of the following purposes. So the first one is to assist in the promotion of financial literacy. Naturally, being a bank, that's something that we're really passionate about, helping people get the basics or get ahead with their financial well-being. The second one is to provide opportunities for all New Zealanders to achieve economic and social independence, however that may be. To provide access to learning opportunities that prepare people for meaningful work and a high quality of life. To assist people working together to create viable and secure communities. So again, that's very broad, you can be very broad with that. And to assist communities to conserve New Zealand's natural and historic resources. So there is a cap on how much you can apply for from the Staff Foundation. That's $25,000 currently. That's the maximum amount. Now, if you do want to apply for $10,000 or more, we do require formally audited accounts. If they are independently reviewed or not audited, you can apply, but only up to sort of $9,999 at the moment. It's just, yeah, part of our screening process for that. There's also areas and a list of what we won't fund. So schools and sports clubs, unfortunately, don't fall under the Staff Foundation. Endowments, and then things that we won't look at are things like fundraising events or campaigns. Fixed assets, so that includes equipment, unless that equipment is critical to the operation of your organisation. So the example that we provide on our webpage is hospice funding. Request for medical equipment to assist patients with home-based care. That's something that we would be able to consider. Capital investments, so new buildings or extensions, that's not something that we can fund through our foundation. And things like normal operating and administrative costs, so salaries. However, that we will give consideration for specialist services. So for example, if you wanted to bring in a counsellor, say, to come in and provide, say, 21-hour sessions at an hourly rate per session, that's something that, yeah, we could consider. Debt repayment, operating budget deficits, costs for overseas conferences and travel, yeah, they're things that are excluded as well. And if you are an organisation that ANZ New Zealand is already sponsoring, we can't consider you for double sponsorship through, for double funding through the foundation. So obviously we have the Staff Foundation, but we also do a lot more besides that in the community, whether that's cricket, netball grants, the Cancer Society and Daffodil Day coming up in a few weeks, or if you've got a really good connection with the branch in your area, you may already have sponsorship from us. So how can you apply for funding from us? Now, we have an ANZ Staff Foundation Hub online, and that's on our website. If you go into I'll put the link up in the chat before I leave today, but it's under the About Us Corporate Responsibility Staff Foundation, or just Google, or however you search engine, ANZ Staff Foundation New Zealand, you'll find us. And you can submit your applications through our online hub. Now, this online hub is very new for us as well. We just launched it for the first time back in February, our last funding round. So we are still learning with you about this at the time, but it's a lot better. I think it used to be that you had to fill in paper forms. So yeah, it's a big jump, it's a lot better. And from our website, yeah, you go in, you can register an account, which you'll need to do first. Once that's been taken care of, you'll get an email, you can log in and submit your application with all the details that we'll need in order to consider you. Now, that webpage also has a step-by-step guide on what you need to do. So firstly, just checking your eligibility, which I've just kind of gone through that with you. Reviewing our terms and conditions, that's really important. Just making sure that you're comfortable with how our processes work, what you're going to be sharing with us and how we keep your information secure. And then there's a step on preparing for your application. So there is some example application questions you can download before you even set up an account with us, if you like, just to sort of see what we're going to be asking for, the questions that we ask, and what we'll need. So as well as your financials and your charity details, we'll need referees from you who are familiar with but independent of your organization. So that could be someone who's benefited from your services, or somebody who is in your community who knows what you do. So yeah, make sure you contact them as well, please, before you submit your application, because part of our process is we will get in contact with them to find out more about the awesome work that you guys do. You've got 1,000 characters in the system, or 200 words or less to tell us about your charity, and then a further 200 words or less to tell us the project or the activity that you're seeking funding for. If you do have projects that cost far beyond $25,000, of course, that's fine. There is just a question in there just around sort of total costs of the project, even if you're just coming to us for a portion of that. And if there is somebody who works for ANZ who supports or has an existing relationship with you, you're more than welcome to include their details in your application. We don't prioritize this anymore, so don't be deterred if you haven't got somebody within the bank that knows you. It's not a deal breaker in any way. Now, the final step, and worth knowing before you begin your application, what if it's successful? So it's important for us that you use the funds within 6 months of receiving them. So for this August funding round, you'd get your payment around the end of October. So you'd have until the end of April next year, or the end of October for the February funding round. So of course, you know, the pandemic has made that quite tricky for a lot of charities, we know. So if there are intervening factors, we can consider extensions on a case-by-case basis. This has happened, you know, quite a bit recently, in the last 2 years. But ideally, yeah, you'd have plans and be able to use those grants within the initial 6 months, because once that time comes around, we do require accountability reports no later than 6 months from when you get your grant. So this is just a summary of your expenditure and supporting evidence of that. So your invoices, bank statements, just as you know, that's really important. If we don't get that, then we might have to request for your grant to be returned. There's also obviously a comm side to being a recipient of an ANZ Staff Foundation grant. We've got an awesome content team here at ANZ, and each funding round they'll get in touch with some of our successful applicants and share information about the impact of the funding. So, you know, we've put out media releases, staff comms, we make some awesome videos. You can check all that out on our news website as well, which I'll link you guys. They're so inspiring. Things like, you know, Richmond Riding for the Disabled is a recent one we've done down in Nelson. The Spirit of Adventure Trust in Auckland, who do 10-day development voyages for 16 to 18 year olds. So yeah, do go and check those out, because yeah, we love making those and sharing those. And if you do get to the end of your 6 months or extended time and you have surplus funds left over, we do require that money is returned. If it's more than a couple of $100, if it's just a small amount, then that's not a problem. So how can you contact us? If you've got any questions about the ANZ New Zealand Staff Foundation, or you need help registering for an account with us using our foundation hub, or completing your application, please do get in touch. We've got a phone number and an email address on that webpage, which will get you through to me or our administrator and accountant, Julie Kellaway. She's been with us since the very start of the foundation in 2000. So she's got incredible knowledge. She's great. Our email address is stafffoundationnz@anz.com. So that's stafffoundationnz@anz.com. That's three S in the middle, Staff Foundation. Or our phone number, it's on there. It's 09252 6563. But yeah, if you do have any questions now, I can try and help. Like I said, I am quite new at the start, so I can't promise I'll be able to answer necessarily, but I will write it down and look to circle back if I can't. But yeah, that's the ANZ New Zealand Staff Foundation.
Brilliant. Thanks, Simon. Question for you. When you talk about the referees, so it can be an individual, not necessarily an organisation.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
Great. Do you have to be an ANZ Bank customer?
No, you don't have to be an ANZ Bank customer at all, no. There's no priority given for that at all.
Would the ANZ Staff Foundation fund other cancer charities given the sponsorship of the Cancer Society's Decadal Day?
Yes. And I believe we have in the past. So on that webpage, you can actually, all of our previous funding recipients for the last few years are on there, and there are, I'm pretty sure, 99.9% sure there are other cancer charities that we have supported, yeah.
Does the ANZ Staff Foundation fund one equipment or two staff salaries and other operating costs? I think you covered that, but do you want to reiterate that?
Yeah, no, unfortunately we can't cover salaries. Equipment is, yeah, it depends what the equipment is and how it fits into sort of the overall project. So I think, you know, the example there was, you know, equipment for a hospice to help with their in-home care. That's something that we might be able to consider, but as a general rule, no, unfortunately not.
Next question. I think you said that you do not support admin costs, but do you support the actual staffing costs that are required for the programs you support? For example, someone to work with a community to set up activities and events for that community. So staffing costs as part of a project.
Yeah, so that's something that we would consider. Yeah, so if the project was something where you needed to bring somebody in for the project, then that's something where we could consider it. I think the example we give is sort of a counsellor coming in and doing counselling sessions. So, I mean, it is case by case and we would have to look quite closely at what that is and et cetera, but it's not, yeah, don't be deterred if it's for something that's specific to the project that you're applying for funding for.
Question from Diane. One of the charities I help has theatre classes for youth in 5 locations. Could one application be made to support performance opportunities in all 5 classes?
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. I guess the tricky thing there would be if they're separate entities or if they have separate, you know, separate finances and all the rest of it, then that could get a little bit tricky. But yeah, if you wanted to get in contact with us about that, we could discuss that a little bit further. Yeah, because if it is just one entity as a whole, but if you want to do it in multiple locations, that's absolutely fine. It'll just be around our accountability reports and your financials and stuff, how we get what we need at our end.
Great, thank you. I think that's the last of the questions online for you. I think I've answered all of those. So I think you need to stand by for an influx of applications, given that your closing date is the 15th of August. So people need to go in and register so that you can apply, particularly personally, loving the fact that you don't longer need an ANZ staff member to support your application, because that was never as straightforward as it sounded. And so that's great. So Simon, thank you. Sincerely appreciate you being here with us this morning. Again, appreciate it wasn't as straightforward technology-wise for you, so it's great. Thank you. We certainly appreciate the information you've shared with us today.
Thank you very much. And I will share the link to the Staff Foundation page in the chat before I go. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. I see that Tom's arrived, so thank you. One more a last poll for today, Simon.
All right, here we go, folks. So question is, how many funding applications do you submit per annum? All right, approaching the 80% mark, so we'll have a few more seconds and then we'll close the poll. Here we go. And results.
Wow, okay, so the vast majority are less than 10. So it's interesting as to whether that's because that covers the funding that you need or whether you don't have enough time to do more, or you're not aware of where else you could be applying to. So obviously there'll be different reasons for that. So if it's because you don't know where else to apply to, hopefully some of the funders that we've covered today are what you can apply to, and also the funding directory that ANCAD have available would certainly be of use to you. We're down to our last speaker for today. So it's from the Lion Foundation. I know it's a funder that will be known to many. Tom is the National Grants Manager. Welcome, Tom. Great that you could join us today. Over to you.
Kia ora, everyone. That's a real nice poll and stat to start with, Simon. Thanks for that. I'd be more interested to see everyone's success rate per application and things like that, because that's where I think we have a heck of a lot of waste in the set. So actually really pleasing to see for me that it's less than 10, and I'm going to again come to a conclusion that maybe people are really strategic about what they're doing. They're applying to the right funder, and actually they don't need to write 40 or 50 applications, of which 20 or 30 get declined. And that's very much my ethos here at Lion. So it's about trying to make good strategic grants and trying to educate and help people understand the best way to fund and how funding works. I've got some slides which I will try to share, and then I'm going to talk to, and then happy to take questions. Are they all coming through you, Stephanie, at the minute? Just give me a thumbs up. Yeah, cool.
Yes, sorry, we missed that at the beginning. So again, questions for Tom in the Q&A box, and we'll answer those at the end.
Cool, great. I'm just going to go back to this. Share screen, this one. Okay, great. Hopefully you'll see in PowerPoint now. Just going to try and change that to view. Which it doesn't want to do. There we go. How's that? Is everyone seeing Lion Foundation Funding Workshop?
Yes, perfect. Great. Thank you.
So we're a class four funder in New Zealand. So class four sector means gaming machines, or what are colloquially referred to as pokies. We're probably the largest in New Zealand, along with NZCT would be a similar size, New Zealand Community Trust. The market is $350 million in a non-COVID year, backed charities in New Zealand. Lion, NZCT, grassroots and pub charity would make up about 50% of that. But the other 50% is covered by another over 30 societies in that space running gaming machines within pubs, clubs, hospitality venues throughout New Zealand. They all operate really differently. They all have different interests, different purposes, different ways of applying. Some you can apply to more than not. More often than not, some are just once a year like us. So really important to do your research on who you're applying to. And then if there's multiple gaming societies in your region, really, really important to understand who's running what pubs and what venues, because 90% for Lion and the majority of funds generated by Class 4 Gaming must go back to its point of origin. Now, these bars, pubs and clubs, they can change whenever they want. Some are very loyal to who they've been with and will stay forever. But some of these, eventually these publicans move on, sell their business, and quite often they change provider of gaming. So the funds available in your area will change depending on who is running those machines. So really, really advantageous to know who's running them. So you can either pop into those venues or go to the websites and check the venue maps of who's got what where. This is an Auckland group, isn't it? So I'm going to start with some bad news, but it's really just the reality of what we're in. Auckland is the most disparate and fractious market within the Class 4 gaming sector. So of those 35 gaming societies, there would be over 30 in Auckland. So historically, Lion would have been very strong in Auckland region, but those little ones are nibbled away. So giving large grants and having lots of money to give away in Auckland is harder than it's ever been. You couple that with a policy from the council, which is what is referred to as a sinking lid, so no more gaming machines. So if a venue closes and isn't bought, those machines are gone for good. And again, you overlay society and the increase dispersedness of Auckland's population and the growth in population, you've got more demand and less supply. For the larger gaming societies. So historically, you might have been writing a couple of applications a year to get $20,000. You might have to write six applications or eight applications to get that money now. There's not a lot we can do about that. That's DIA-led, and it is just the way of the sector. We hope Lion will get stronger in the Auckland region, but currently, I would say in the Auckland region alone, I might have $200,000 a month to give away. When I started this job, it was probably $600,000 to $700,000 a month. That was 3 years ago. And I'd have $1.5 million worth of applications. So the demand is still there, but you can't get a grant if you don't apply. And that very much lends itself towards the geographical nature of funding. Lion Foundation is incredibly strong in the Waikato Bay of Plenty area, and you've listed some areas there. If you're in Whakatane, Western Bay of Plenty, Tauranga, and Waikato, we fund, I think, nearly 9 out of 10 applications in those areas, whereas in Auckland, it would be 2 to 3 out of 10.
So it is really, really harder in the class four market in the Auckland region. So it is more important than ever to know where your venues are and how those venues perform. When you apply with class four funding, it's going to be ring fenced to an authorized purpose. So what you want to spend it on, we'll talk about that a bit more there. But try and apply for things that are really clean. So it could be, you know, one item, one big item that you're going for, or it could be a contribution towards person X's salary. But provide all that information as well, because the process is slowed down if your application is incomplete, because we'll come back to you and ask for more stuff. You'll go away and get it. So really focus on getting your application complete. And there's a checklist at the back. Now, unlike other societies, lots of people have a cutoff date, like the last Friday of the month or the first Monday of the month or whatever it might be. At Lion, we're so big that we deal with so much quantum. We do 4,500 grants a year we receive, and we'd fund probably about 3,000 of those. Were we to set a cutoff date, all we're doing is creating a bottleneck for my team every month that they wouldn't actually be able to keep with. So we have a process where once your application's submitted, and as long as it's complete, you will get a decision within 6 to 8 weeks. 98% of our grants are 6 to 8 weeks. If it goes over 8 weeks, it's generally because we've requested information and haven't received it back. Bit of criteria around class four funding. Your organisation needs to be incorporated, apart from schools. You must be not-for-profit and be able to provide proof that you're not-for-profit, so charity CC number or evidence from the IRD that you're income tax exempt. You can do that by taking a screenshot on my IRD. And then any sports clubs that apply with OSASCA affiliation to your regional bodies. DIA rules, Gambling Act rules, 2003. Some line rules. You're only allowed one successful application every 12 months, but you can really truck and trailer those. So if it's sort of 10 months from your application, you should absolutely be thinking about pulling together your next one, because we will have ordered it and got all that done by the time your other one gets processed. As a rule of thumb, and I've talked about geography a lot, your organisation wants to be within 5 kilometres. Now, you can get a bit clever. It doesn't have to be your organisation or the postcode that you're applying from. It could be where you deliver the activity that you're asking money from. So you can try and work around that as best you can. Now, there is an asterisk there as well. We would never fund anything rural if we applied that rule to the letter. So things like surf clubs, could be mountain bike tracks, could be outward bound centres, rural communities. We recognise that 5K is actually quite short. So yeah, we can fund things further than that. But in general, when you're talking about inner Auckland venues, we want to fund things within a 5 kilometre radius. The audit from your previous grant must be completed before you apply. Again, just make sure you're tailoring those, truck and trailer them next to each other so that you're completing one as you're applying for the next. We need lots of stuff from you when you apply. A cover letter is always nice. Do not be writing 3 or 4 page cover letters. It's not necessary. Do your best to be complete and concise. Bullet point what you need to get across. If you've got a clear, well-known charity, we probably know about you. Talk about your purpose, talk about what the grant's going to do, how it's going to change the lives of people in the community around you. Do it concisely as you can. A resolution, so generally that's a point in your minutes from when the board met or when your trustees met, just to say we are applying for a Lion Foundation for up to $10,000, signed off. Proof of your incorporation and not-for-profit status, touched on those before. Affiliation if you're a sports club, from your member body. And then we like to see some financials within the last 18 months. So whether that's a balance sheet or a profit and loss, just to see the finances of your organisation. They don't need to be fully audited. They just need to be clean and clear and presentable. When you apply, if you're applying for, say, equipment for sport, we like to see 2 quotes, and we are permitted to only fund the smallest amount, so the best, most competitive quote. And then you'll just have to do a few other little things like prove your bank account number. That's only if we haven't funded you before. If you've been funded before, that's absolutely fine. And if you are doing capital projects, and in Auckland capital projects are pretty rare at the moment, but we won't fund any projects until consent has been granted. I see have lots of people come to me and telling me the project's going to start, but consent can drag and take ages, and sometimes you're past the 12 months audit time frame, so we don't touch those until we've got consent in place. This is a really quick one about how to write what we call a good authorized purpose. Now, the first thing that I try to describe here is that there's a question in your grant application, say, what is the grant's specific purpose? Whatever you write in here is what is referred to as the authorized purpose, and it's the legal thing that your grant can be spent on. So if we put towards the salary of Tom Smith, and I'm the sports development officer for Active Auckland or whoever else, or Harbour Sport, if I leave 6 months through the year and you funded a year's worth of my salary, for the second 6 months, they could not use that money because the person comes, unless the person's called Tom Smith as well, which is more likely than most names, but fairly unlikely. So when you write your authorized purpose, the position, not the person. Okay. In your evidence, you may well include the job description and a signed contract from that person, but in the authorized person, put the position, not the person. So the same theory can be applied for an item. And the example here that we use is a van purchase. Now, if you say we're going to buy a 2022 Toyota Hiace van to transport the kids to X, Y, or Z, you can only buy a 2022 Toyota Hiace van. And by the time you've done the rest of your fundraising, they might not have any in stock and they might have a Nissan X, Y, Z. You cannot buy the Nissan X, Y, Z if you've said you're going to buy a Toyota. If you put van purchase, you can purchase any van, or some great deal could have come up on a secondhand van. You can use that money towards the purchase of a van. And the final example in this sort of little tip section is around events. And this happened all the time through COVID. The example here could have been Christmas in the park, or it could have been St. Patrick's Day fun day. Event got cancelled because of COVID. If it just read towards the cost of community event and you put on the event in 6 months later or 3 months later when the country was back open, we can allow that to be spent on the same sort of infrastructure and the same things that you're going to. But that it was for a Christmas fun, you can't tell me that it can't be used for the grant in the Easter community day. So we call this being vague but specific, which I know is a complete oxymoron, a stupid way to describe it. But really just being a bit vague in your authorized purpose will give you more flexibility on your grant as things change. Just a few more tips. So yeah, I mentioned capital builds in your application to us. Really do be concise. Like I said, it's thousands of a year. Get to the point of what you're trying to say. Show us the impact quickly. Allow plenty of time for your application. So we need 6 to 8 weeks. If your event's in 2 months, you are going to cut it fine. You want to be taking a good 3 or 4 month run at this, to be honest. Be applying 3 or 4 months out from your event or your point of delivery. People always ask us, what shouldn't I, can't I apply for? Well, we often say, what's the thing that you need most and what's the costs that are easy to prove? We do fund salaries. People ask me that all the time. It's going to come up in another slide later, but I know people are asked that. It is incredibly unlikely in the Auckland market right now. If we were in the Waikato Bay of Plenty, absolutely we'd do some salaries. But right now to fund new salaries in Auckland with the drought in funds that we had would be extremely unlikely. If you're coming to us, I would focus your applications on OPEX, equipment, and other costs that you might be able to then rob Peter to pay Paul. But we do fund new salaries. If you want to give it a shot, you can give it a shot, but it is really tight at the moment. If you're a sports body, my advice is stop puffing your chests out and talking about scholarships and high performance and elite and our first 11 and our first 15. Class 4 funding is not there to support people that are already in sport. It's not there to support people that are fit to get fitter. It is there to support the grassroots of games. So talk about your inclusion program, your program for kids, your program that's a development program or getting people back into your sport, or how it's keeping people in your sport. We are not there here to support what you would consider high performance. We've all been affected by COVID. As an organization, we'd like to move forward and just hear the positive stuff, talk about the future rather than how you've been affected by COVID. We know you've been affected by COVID. Be more positive and talk about what you want to do over the next 12 to 24 months. talk about the mixed economy of funding. If you're applying for a large amount, the trustees like to see that you're doing some fundraising yourselves internally, that money's coming from other areas, that you're utilising assets you have. So present what I refer to as a mixed economy in your funding. Another nice one is, yeah, think of us as the cherry on the top. We don't want to see applications where we are solely reliant. That can be a red flag to the trustees. If and when you're successful, please spend the money. We get loads of refunds. Do spend it. Don't spend it until you've got your approval through. Once you've got your approval, you can spend. Only spend it on that authorised purpose that we spent a bit of time talking about, and do complete your audit within the stated time frame. But if it's a quick project and you're done within a month and the money's spent and you've got a receipt for it, send it in, get it done, get it ticked off, do it nice and timely. Some of these will be starting to line up in questions, but I thought I'd try and cut a few off before we get to questions. So like I mentioned, we don't have a cut off. We have a rolling application that runs 24/7, 12 months a year. Our regional grants committees meet in the second week of every month, and every grant that goes through them is ratified by our board on the last Monday of every month. There's the salaries one. Yes, we do fund salaries, but big sort of slice of advice, really, in the Auckland market right now, it would be a long shot. If you're anywhere else in the country or you work with other people in the country, yeah, salaries are probably absolutely a go, but right now in Auckland, really tricky. No upper limit on what you can apply for. I always tell people to shoot for the moon because you might land among the stars, but also be a bit realistic. If you're a charity that turns over 200k a year, don't be applying for 150k or 100, like, we're not going to fund that. That looks silly. So be optimistic, but also keep it respectful and relevant to the size of organisation that you are. Can you spend your money on something else if your event's cancelled? So I think within the AP example I gave, only if you've written your authorised purpose really vaguely. Do fund capital projects. Again, we tend to be the cherry on top of the cake. If you don't have income tax exemption, then you need to find a way of getting charitable status. It's actually quite quick and quite easy to do. You probably could get income tax exemption. It's just a letter from the IRD, or you can just ask an accountant to write a letter as well to us. We can't fund individuals in any way, shape, or form. So you can't apply for individual expenses or anything that benefits an individual. There's a section on our website, and lots of this information is on our website. There's actually a recorded funding forum you can watch. It's about 40 minutes long, which is a bit more detailed than what I've had time for today. And there's also a slideshow of how to complete our online grants form that's really useful as well. Together with that is this page around how you can say thanks. Love to get tagged in your social media posts. We love to see some pictures. Kids from school send us stuff in. If you want to put signage up, that's all great. You can actually get signage through us as well if you want flags and gazebos and things like that from events. So that's all on the website under the section of how you can say thanks. We are not allowed to request that from you, but believe me, we love it when you do it, and we're very, very thankful for it. That's contact details for Lion Foundation, the 0800 number's the best one there. Or there's the, it's not on there, info@lionfoundation.org.nz, but lots of the information is on the website. A good bit of advice is if you're unsure, pick up the phone and give us a call, because a 2-minute phone call could save you writing a grant that you're never going to get, and sort of the whole day's worth of work that it takes getting those quotes, getting your board members to sign off, doing your cover letters. Sometimes a 2-minute conversation, I can cover off either a bit of advice that will be really crucial to your application, or potentially stop you making an application that there is no way you're going to get funding for. And I would rather put that time back into you applying to someone else where you might get funding. Right, that was a real whistle stop. I'm going to stop sharing now, and I'm happy to take a few questions if there's time.
Great. Thanks, Tom. Appreciate that. So yeah. One question, you mentioned about the van and being vague, you know, slightly vague in the purpose, and that you said if you get a great deal, it enables you to purchase that van. Does it still have to be from the suppliers who quoted, or can you go to another supplier whose quotes you didn't include in your application?
Yeah, so yeah, let's say you applied for 20 grand, I only gave you 15 and you couldn't find the other five, and then another supplier came up with a secondhand van. You can just contact us, submit a new invoice as proof of cost for the 15 grand van, and you can put 15. You know, if it was 16, you could put a grand of your own money to it. But yeah, no, you can, if the authorized purpose is clean, you can resubmit new quotes as cost evidence for us. We'll add those. It's all about us just leaving a breadcrumb trail for the auditor. If they pick out your grant, I need to show them why we did what we did.
Mm-hmm. So if you want to go to purchase the van, in this case, from another supplier who didn't quote, just to confirm that with you, send a copy of the quote to you to get signed off before you
purchase. Absolutely. We'll add it in, and then that's all clean and clear, and you're not getting any trouble, and I won't get in any trouble.
Perfect. Okay. Questions. We've recently set up a new trust that has received funding from our former trust, who we are now a member organisation of, but we are less than 12 months old. What is the best way to move forward with making an application? Do we apply through the new trust or the former trust?
So yeah, I see what you're saying. The new trust doesn't have 12 months of accounts to prove, which is a requirement for us to understand there. So I've had this one where people will just wait for the 12 months to understand the relationship between the old trust and how that's connected to the new trust and whether that's applicable to apply to the old one. It wouldn't be applicable for that one. That would almost be third party funding, which would be very much frowned upon. My advice would be is if you can get through this 12 months, then just start lining up your applications for sort of 10 months into that, or when you can prove your accounts. It's hard to know without knowing the full specifics.
Fair enough.
Sorry, that's not a great answer.
Next one. I've looked at your website and read that your priorities include art and culture, health, sport, education. Do you fund environmental or animal welfare orientated charities? Or do we need to focus on the people side of the organisation, e.g. volunteers, community benefit of what we do?
No, absolutely. The community bit does encompass sort of environmental charities and animal charities as well. So mobility assistance dogs trust, pest free, capity, like there are just a few that I can remember off the top of my head that have been through recently. No, absolutely. Yeah, they'll come under that. I think that community piece. Yeah. And Line is probably, compared to a lot of the others, we're probably one of the more open funders in terms of the arts and culture as well. Lots of the NZCTs and grassroots are very much more sport focused. We're still 40% sport, but we do split our money a little bit wider.
Thank you. So following up on that last question, would you be available to fund tech-based community projects?
Yeah.
That was easy. Okay. Any other couple of seconds? Any more questions for Tom? Or else we can let him go to get on with the rest of his day.
That was great. I hope people found that useful. As I said, there's lots more resources on the website and a full funding forum there. If not, get in touch via our info line. We can sign you up to our Lions Pride newsletter as well. And there's regular live funding forums that we do monthly as well. But if you don't have time to make that slot, there's a really good one of myself and Mike Roke delivering a funding forum, which covers 99.9% of what you'd ever need to know and a little bit more detail than what I had time to do. That's about 40 minutes rather than 20. So it'd be really, really useful just to sit down and watch that.
Brilliant. Thanks, Tom. Certainly appreciate your time today. It's been really useful. So thank you.
Lovely to be able to connect. Thanks a lot, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.
Great. So that ends our funding fair, ends our presentations for today. So on behalf of Waione Brennan and the team at ANCAD, I sincerely thank each of our speakers for taking the time to join us today. It is appreciated. And I thank you all for attending. I hope you found it worthwhile and your grant funding increases as a result. Just a reminder that the speakers' presentations will be emailed. And don't forget to get your copy of the 2020 funding directory via the ANCAD website, which is ancad.org.nz, and to check out the other training opportunities that ANCAD has available with thanks to the Tyndall Foundation. A quick two-question survey should appear as I end this webinar, so please take a moment to answer that. It's really, your feedback's really important. So hopefully, fingers crossed, that'll work. So again, thanks to all. Take care and enjoy the rest of your day.